pine cone. Life's longing for life. Wind winding, coning down the ground. Life's love for life. Waves of waving purples and yellows. Singing chimes upon my eyes. Yellow purple, symbiotic spectrum. Bluebells flowing. The sounds of growing. Fragrant fertility, flowering my imagination. Canopies of greens painted on a blue canvas. Fallen trees, fertile ground. Rotting life, living death. Clouds appearing through the green, disappearing through the green. The power of cumulonimbus, the permanence of high cirrus.
I got the idea to become an astronaut when the National Academy of Science and NASA got together and considered how they might enhance the return from space by flying people with a scientific background. It was at that point that I saw the door opening up. At that time, I said, I'm a space person. I am a space person. Space is my calling. And so one day with my surgical boss, I was scrubbing for an operation. And he said, how come you're not going to be with us next year? And I said, sir, because I am going into space. And you might have expected some reaction on his part to say, oh, sure. But he said, he looked me in the eye in earnest, and he said, help. About 2 years after I said, I am a space person. An announcement of opportunity went out, and I applied to NASA, and I was accepted. And so that was the beginning of my formal career with NASA. It was an incredible epiphany in my life. It was a juncture. I remember the desk I was sitting at when Alan Shepard called, and he said, how would you like to move to Houston, Texas? Yes, sir. So that was that. And so I was a space person in spirit. I was a space person in my imagination, my identity, all of those things. In a way, you didn't need to send me in space. As soon as I'm a space person, I became a space person. And so then it was 16 years to my first flight. I was debriefing crews that were going to Apollo. I was in mission control when we landed on the moon, and very shortly thereafter, I had to walk outside to the parking lot and look at the moon and say, there's people there. Apollo 13, the disaster, I was in mission control and all that. I was not selected for my artistic skills or for my sensibilities, which lay in the realm of art, or for the way that I work in the human world, which is to always be on the edge, always trying to push forward, always trying to explore, as artists do, I'm always walking the edge and always did. And so if you want to hang one label on me, even though you're missing all the rest, it's not scientist, it's artist. In the selection process, which is there to select scientists, I don't think it limits them to science. It only means that they have some scientific ability. But I was technical. I lived in disciplines that, like flying, you do it right or you die. I was a surgeon in which I have to have discipline. I have to operate based on the known technology out there, or my patients are going to die. I was a parachutist with 600 parachute jumps. I had to do that right. So I lived in technology. I lived in science. And so I demonstrated that I could be disciplined. I demonstrated that I could live within certain operational and intellectual paradigms. And it turns out I can be more severe about details than anyone in NASA. I acquired the name Dr. Details because of my exasperating pursuit of detail. And so I know how to do that world. But I never looked upon myself as an artist. It's only after the fact that when people, you know, perceive that we've got to cut you up, we've got to find out what part of you is what, only then did the word artist enter into my thinking. One thing I created as an astronaut in space was to take a biological creature, this creature, and to drop it in space flight. Let space flight do its thing on it. And then to, in an inward turn, perceive what was happening to it. And so it's just drop it out there. It's let space flight do whatever it wants to it. It's like water. But let the space flight mold it, or it's like clay. Space flight is going to mold that clay. An artistic, poetic kind of sensibility says, I am going to surrender to the environment. I'm going to surrender to the machine. I'm not going to control it. It's going to control me. I am going to become one with the environment. I am a space person. And the only way you become a space person is to surrender to space. The poetic sensibility says, I cannot catch that environment unless it affects me. Now, that's different than conquer. That's different than conquer. To conquer another environment means I stay the same. The term conquer space, of course, was everywhere in the 50s and the 60s. We're going to conquer space. Well, do you look at what does that mean? What that means is I'm going to bring my Earth-based person up there, and I'm going to stay an Earth-based person. If you go into another culture to conquer another culture, what you're saying is, I bring my culture to this culture. I'm not going to understand the new culture. I want to bring my culture into it. I write both in my official flight log, which I carry, and I also write in my little black notebook that has the 100 or so things that I want to accomplish on my mission. And so I leave enough space to write the results in there. Sometimes the results are so self-evident, and so the ecstasy that goes with the finding, I don't need to write that down or to record it. It's here and here. But I do keep, I have a tape recorder And I have my own NASA notebook, and I have my own little black book. And of course, I have the other kind of products that come out of video recording or photographs or air-to-ground transmissions and all of that. For a lot of people, adaptation to space is not nice. 50% of astronauts are sick for a day or two or almost three. And I never get sick in space. I'm fortunate, or I do the right things to get ready. It is a rather harsh camping trip, and maybe that is why most astronauts do not stay in the program. It is a harsher camping trip than is communicated. It doesn't mean it's harsh on me. I accept that, and I go forward with it, and I do the camping trip. But I'm able to see beyond the camping trip. There may be 30 minutes out of every hour, which is part of the camping trip, and the other 30 minutes is ecstasy. But I did loads of things even before my first flight, just because it was fun. The sleeping heads down, the putting boards underneath the foot of my bed so that I would be sleeping in a heads down direction, pushed a lot more blood headward, which occurs in the free fall condition. And so I got used to having what we call the big head. Almost everyone gets headaches from the headward flow of fluid, the increased venous pressure to the head and all that. But of course I never did, because I accommodated to that before I went. So I enjoyed watching television upside down. So I would be sitting here in this gravitational field in my chair with the gravity from the ceiling to the floor, but I would take the television and turn it like that. So the story that I'm immersing myself in out there, I have to put together the other way around, because the narrative that I'm looking at in the television, the gravity is passing in that direction. So I am existing in this gravitational field, and the storyline that I'm putting myself into, the gravity goes the other way. I read books upside down. I read books. I got so that I could turn a book upside down and read it in either direction at about the same time if it was right side up, going like that. I would read it upside down. I would read the sentences backwards, and I would read the story going backwards. And of course, I think this is more of a stretch to say this is going to help me in zero gravity, except in space, you do not go around with your feet towards the floor and your head toward the ceiling. You will dive down through the hatch and you'll pick up a control and display panel immediately. You don't have the time to always go around like this. You do face control and display panels very often upside down, in which the letters are backwards and the letters are upside down. And also, you have trained that you want this function, the switch goes up. In zero gravity, you approach the panel like this, and you, for a given function you are trying to accomplish, the switch no longer goes up, it goes down with respect to you. My own theory on adaptation to space and space motion sickness is one component to that is wanting to have things happen which are unusual. Wanting to have perceptions of a different reality than you're used to. Even wanting illusions to occur and thinking that they are fun. It's wanting to have an experience of the real thing and an experience of the unreal things. And so you go into space with a looseness. But it gets back to the idea of, if you want to understand space, you have to give yourself over to it. If you resist becoming a space creature, it's going to hurt. I think one reason it goes easy for me is because I want things to happen. I want space to affect me. I want it to move me. I want it to do things to me. And when it does things to me, I say, isn't that nice? It's fun, you know? And when your body is giving you information that is counter to what your intellect tells you, when you get a miscompare between your body and your mind, that for me is exciting. I love it when I talk to my body and say, how could you possibly see things that way? My body always wins. My body always wins. I always give in. But I find it absolutely marvelous when my body goes one way and my mind the other. When my body tells me, as one example, in the middle of the night, that it wishes to turn over, and I tell my body, hey, fella, it's not going to get you anywhere. It's not getting you anything. We are in free fall. We are in zero gravity, and turning over in this bed or wherever we are is not going to get you anything, and we don't need to do it. And we try that for a while, and then my body tells me, if you don't turn me over, you are in for a rough night. And I see that, yes, the body's right. Okay, I'll turn it over. And then things go well. So, but it is that miscompare at times between the physical self, which is trying to come to grips with an environment that it was not designed to be in. We, of course, did not get dropped in a gravitational field. We are gravity, and we are Earth. We are gravity, and it is part of our formal, hardwired constitution. And so it is us. And when you go out there in a free-fall condition, the body is unable to cope with the different signals. Near space, when you look out there, of course, it's this fantastic darkness. And the darkness is different in the light than when you're... Call it the blackness, call it the darkness. The language has no term for it. The darkness has a different texture. And this is so real, you feel you can touch it. The vacuum. And of course, it's not a vacuum, it's the cosmos. It's very energetic, and it has lots of messages and things in it. It's very rich. And in sunlight, I have the sun, like the sun coming from behind me, to light the darkness. There is nothing there, I guess there is nothing there, for the eye to perceive, to have the light come back. But there must be something that is sending light back your way, because the darkness is different in daylight than at nighttime. I describe it as a velvet. It's infinitely flexible, it's infinitely moldable, and it doesn't resist you in any way. Well, it does a little. It resists you enough to be able to, like you could reach out and touch it. It's like a black marshmallow. It's like, oh, I know what it's like. It's like a whey water. It's like a very thin water, except you almost perceive that it has a temperature, and it's not wet. And so, but it's like it had some medium to it. It's like if you were to move through it, it would be something. It would be something with the hands, you know, something you could feel. something you could feel flow by you, something that might be a little spongy. But when you look at the darkness in the light, you see it. The view out the window certainly tends to prevent you from getting cabin fever, because when you have your nose on a window and you see for thousands of miles, you tend to forget that you have a closet behind you. But I do look upon it not as a tension, I look upon it as a continuum. I can be way away from the window and I just get a little view of maybe the earth or maybe the heavens. And so here then I'm pretty much encapsulated by my surroundings, but as I approach the window frame, I am going more and more to the outside, and I leave the inside behind me. And so it is, you know, this kind of thing in the window frame. My principal experience of the tightness or the incredible expansiveness comes from my experiments or my wanting to sleep a different way every night. And so most of the time during the day, I don't creep into a steel corner that grabs me and just holds me really tight. I most of the time did that to have a different experience of sleep, in which sometimes I would sleep floating, and so then only in the air. I have absolutely no constraints. I am letting the body take its own shape. And so every single joint you have, that's called extension, and that is flexion. Or if you have the elbow, you know, that's flexion, and that is extension. But when you totally relax, then there are tensions in these muscles, that one extension and flexion, that joint arrives at the neutral point, as does this one and that one, the wrist. Every single vertebrae you have, every joint you have in the body then, with total relaxation, arrives at the in which there are equivalent forces on either side. And so now that is a sense of real freedom. In the dark or passing off to sleep, you know intellectually where your body is, but you no longer have contact with it. It's not like sleeping. When you sleep on a bed down here, you have the contact of your limbs on the bed and you feel the bed. But also down here, because gravity has flattened you, it is pushing the body in a place that it is not just floating. And so it is forcing the joints and all, and that puts tension on the joints and the cartilage and everything else. So in a way, sleeping in 1G, you have a sense of where you are. But in this totally neutral kind of becoming water and air, you lose contact with your body. There's nothing to tell you where it is. And so you don't know where your limbs are. You lose contact with them. And to regain the contact, you can push them out into some place which is not the balance. And then you totally relax and let them go, and they fall back into, they oscillate until they have arrived at this point here. And so this is things, you know, I could go on forever. You do feel. You can feel the heart also can give you some sense of the body because it is moving. Every pulse that goes out, the pulse, of course, is inertial. It's increasing the pressure. And so you have a little extension like this. And so in a way, you get a little contact with the body with each pulse that goes out. It's a real art how to drop yourself perfectly. An improper drop, you will make spaceship contact in 10 minutes. But if I do a very nice drop, I'm off to solid sleep before I make the next contact with the ship. But watching myself a perfect drop, then I don't know where the spaceship is around me. I have no idea. I also do not know where I am over the Earth, nor do I know where the Earth is, nor do I need to know where the Earth is or where the spaceship is. It's out of my mind. This is as delicious as it gets. But you now achieve some other state in which you're almost watching, I don't know what it is, but I appear to watch myself dream. I somehow move outside of the spaceship. Of course I am not. But I move out and I watch myself circling Earth from a distance, and which is really delicious. So I see myself floating in the spaceship and going around. And so that is really neat. But the awareness, for some reason, becoming totally disembodied, and I have no idea what is going on here, but I am becoming so totally disembodied, my awareness has increased of whatever I'm aware of. It's sort of an awareness of nothing, but it has a higher and higher level. I don't know if we went where you plan to go. Sounds. There are certain rocket firings you can hear. It shakes the whole vehicle. And so they're like cannons going off. They are very impressive sounds. But they make the whole thing shudder and shake. And so when you're floating in the air, you only hear them by air travel. If you want to hear them in different ways, you can put your head against the metal, and that'll give you a good ride. You put your head against them, get shook that way. You hear that way, of course, too. I heard the rockets during a spacewalk once, my first one, and I said, you didn't hear that. You don't hear in a vacuum. But my peripheral vision caught the rocket going off, and I heard it, and I says, uh-oh, we gotta find out what's going on here. And turned out my suit was pressed against the shuttle. And so the vibration of the shuttle vibrated my waist ring, which vibrated the air inside. I heard. And all of those things gave me sound in a vacuum. From that, I got the idea that I should be able to talk to someone else in a vacuum if I were to press my faceplate against theirs. I could now talk on this side, vibrate my faceplate, which would vibrate theirs, and on their side, they would hear. And it works. So, in a serendipitous kind of way, I came up with how you might talk to someone else if they've lost communication. You simply push up to them and talk. Outside, you have a fan all the time, and that's the fan that's running your suit. So that fan runs all the time. It's a very, very steady hum. It's not an obnoxious hum. It's a nice kind of hum. Let's see, I get the frequency. But less than that. There it is. The sound in the ship is fans. It's its fans. And the fans are loud. It is very nice when you go to what's called change out the lithium hydroxide cartridge. That's what absorbs the carbon dioxide out of your air. That is a nice silence. So a free fall silence, a zero G silence, is very different. It's a deep silence. The fans created a reverberation and created music that I heard. And that continues to grow and grow and grow until I'm hearing detailed instruments. And that is an incredibly, just a glorious, magnificent music. But it becomes overwhelming because you just don't know where it's coming from after a while. So in terms of sounds, I think that's probably it. I have often thought about the sounds coming from Earth. I have thought that would be a delicious thing to be able to listen to Earth whirling by. There's two critical points on readaptation to Earth. One thing which is sort of startling is that after hundreds of millions of years of creation and evolution, that 1 week in space, you have to get reacquainted with Mother Earth, of which you are. You are Mother Earth. Earth formed you over that whole period of time. And after just 1 week out there, you have to get reacquainted. But it speaks for the adaptability. It speaks for the modifiability of the biological system. It speaks in a very healthy way for its ability to change it over a very short period of time, to adapt and make itself comfortable and survive in a very different environment and it was probably not evolved to be in. The second point is that with every subsequent mission, and this is not in the books anywhere, adaptation to space gets easier and easier with every mission. My first one, it was only 5 days long in my 40s. I had to have my eyes to maintain my balance and to even stand up. I would not have been able to walk with my eyes closed. Everything was very heavy. Everything was very unsteady. If I sat for long, it was almost like an arthritis came over my whole body. If I sat in one position for long on the first day back or the second day, I could barely make it out of the chair. My second flight was 8 days, but it was easier than my first. Skipping ahead to my last flight in my 60s, which was an 18-day flight, I had adapted before I landed. After we landed, I walked off as if I had been nowhere. I had no ill effects. I had no anything. I went about my business. Even my fifth flight. We landed around 1 a.m. I went through 4 or 5 hours of rigorous medical exams, got on an airplane, flew back to Houston, and I made it to work by 8 a.m. And I worked a full day, and at 6 p.m., I went home. Huh. I think I'm adaptive. I think I'm adaptive. I think I'm moldable. I think I'm like water. I think I'm moldable. I think I'm comfortable. I think I'm comfortable in an environment that is counter to the one that formed me. I think it is compatible with my philosophy of there's only one thing constant in our universe, and that is change. And that is continual evolution in all the forms, physical, spiritual, any way you want. Change is the only constant. Uvea was a work of art. Of course, I have 100. But Uvea is, it's a work of art. It's like it's hanging right here. It's very thin at the top, and then it widens out down here. It's very thin, the necklaces. And to the south, then it's very thick, and it thickens out. And it's got like, you know, it's like a bunch of emeralds, and it's got gold rimmed, the beaches around it. But it's not just Uvea, of course, it's the blues of the water. It's the classical cloud pattern. Uvea does not usually have cumulus clouds. It's got wispy cirrus. It's got very, very light clouds, very wispy clouds. Very light clouds, so it goes with it. And the blues in the lagoon, and the blues outside, the deeper water, the shallower water, it was just a work of art. It came upon me. It came into the window. And one of the most marvelous experiences that I had was on my last flight when I didn't know I was in the region. And we were going along in a funny kind of attitude where the shuttle was like this. And in the particular window where I was in, I couldn't see the future. I didn't know. I had no idea where we were going. I'm sort of looking backwards, coming out from underneath like this. So I see what's behind me, but I don't see what's ahead of me. And I'm not that sure. I don't need to know where I am. I know I'm in the general vicinity out there, the coral sea or somewhere out there. But it's not what I'm doing in life. I'm simply looking at the beauty. I don't need to name it, and I don't need to know exactly where I am. I'm just looking at beauty. But I'm just there in the window watching the world come out like this, and all of a sudden, there. Uvea, it just came. It just came from out underneath. There was no qualitative epiphany in space. I have been, as long as I can remember, the same individual. The same belief system, the same spirituality, totally driven by spirituality, driven by the quest. None of that changed. It was enriched thank goodness I got there, because it was massively enriched. It was expanded, but not qualitatively different. Instead of going into the forest, I viewed the Earth and the cosmos from there. Instead of a little raft that I built at the age of 5 to go floating down the river. And at the age of 5, I didn't want to know where I was either. I lay on my back on the raft so that I wouldn't see where I was. And I navigated and I studied the currents by how the leaves and the trees overhead went. I didn't want to see the shoreline. And I would lie on my back and only view the branches overhead. I could tell when I was in a whirlpool by the branches overhead doing this. And I could get a sense of when I moved on, I could get a sense of my velocity. But after a while, you don't know where you are. You don't know how far down the river you've gone. And for me, it is such a simple thing, you know, an immense sense of wholeness, an immense sense of ecstasy, a sense of oneness. It's one of those things. It's one of where I am the cosmos. I am part of this process that I am doing. I'm part of it. I'm molecules. My molecules are those molecules. The stars that die, that's me. It's that.
Birds and songs, bird songs. Life calling to life. Honeysuckle, honeybee, sensuous sucking stingers, sweet sugar of life. Spider's web, life catching life, death preserving life. Woodwinds, leaves talking in the winds, symphonies of green, kinesthetic kaleidoscopes. Dead leaves, live leaves, death. Blossoms blooming, seed sowing, spring springing, mosquito skimming, blood to blood, life to life. Fields of flower, waves of color, birds soaring on a solar wind, seeds soaring on a solar soil, my soul soaring.
The most powerful experiences I had in nature was in an environment like this. The forest, it was evergreen forest, like this. As far back as I can remember, at the age of 3, I was out in this kind of environment and in the nighttime. And this was the most powerful world I had. Floating down the river on my rafts was very archetypal too, but this is where it really was, right here. I felt the greatest strength. I was stronger here. One might think in some way that I was vulnerable. This is where my strength was. This is where my sense of being was, this is where I was at my best. I was the most peaceful here, the most serene here. I looked upon this as my world. The silence was just penetrating. It was a deep silence. At night, other than the owls were marvelous. The melodic hoots, they were almost friends, but the songbirds, of course, were quiet at night. So it was just owls. I could hear the trees. I could hear them when they moved. You can hear the little creak in the wood, not even the branches touching, but the creak in the wood. And one of the most powerful sounds for me was the wind through the pine needles. So the wind through the pine needles is something that even today is really powerful anywhere it occurs. But the carpet, the pine carpet was so quiet. I could walk so quiet. But the only threat I had was the branches, so I always had to lead. I had to just lead, you know, with a hand, because I couldn't see the branches. But she had different shadows. I could see the stars, of course. And the moonlight night was very different. I'd use the stars to navigate, to find my way both in and out, and of course I would use the moon as well, if there was one. But I could tell by the bark, the trees, I could feel the bark. I'd just grab the tree and keep going in the direction that the tree felt the same. Didn't really know what I was doing, but it worked. I always went alone. I always went alone throughout my entire childhood and on through school. I always went alone. In the daytime, I would go to the forest with my younger brother. The night experience, I think it had to be alone. My mom was a very sweet person. She was very supportive. She was unconditional love. She was just small to medium built and brown hair. Her hair never grayed, not a gray hair in her 70s. So very few wrinkles and very athletic. She was a good athlete when she was young. But a serene and quiet and composed. Yeah, that's Mom. I had a very warm relationship with her. There was a difficult period when things got really mean for her with my father, and she became an alcoholic. And so I didn't even know what that was. But so that was really rough on her, but we carried on, and it was rough on me too when she left Dad, and it was me and her, and so I ran the house while she got over that. So she was probably a really hard alcoholic for 5 years, 6 years, and then she recovered on her own. I did try to get her institutionalized, but I didn't. At the age of 10 and 11, you don't have much authority. But I did not get help from the relatives to get that done, so we carried on. They had to separate, so otherwise they'd have killed each other. So they had to separate, and that was very clear, and it should have happened years and years earlier. So the separation was not a bad thing. The fact they stayed together was a bad thing. We didn't go that far away geographically, so I'd still work on the farm for Dad after she left. I really don't know what she thought of me back then. I'm sure she adored me, and she knew I was different. She knew I was very different, and she treated me as different. She treated me as if I was 10 years older than I was. And I not only went with her, I supported her, and I spoke it the way it was. I told him who he was and what he was, and, you know, at the age of whatever. I always stood up. And, of course, with Mom at my defense, so. Now, he was pretty rough on everybody, but he might have been rough on me, but he didn't move me. I knew me. At the earliest age, I looked around and said, man, what kind of place is this? But I said, it's not me. I am me, and that out there is that out there. It's not me. I didn't cause that, and I'm not part of that, and I'm not getting it on me. You could not hurt me. See, because I had the self. I was wrapped up in self. I knew who I was, and I was out in the forest. I said, this is me. I said, that's my strength. And you think a three-year-old out here is in some way vulnerable. No, this is my world. And so this was my sense of, you know, who I am and my confidence, and this is where I grew. And so he couldn't hurt me. As mean, and he was very mean and very malicious. Physically, psychologically, however, but he couldn't touch me. He couldn't touch me. There were all kinds of unwritten rules, and nobody could visit. The relatives couldn't visit, and it became so miserable, they'd leave. And so nobody could visit, and we never did anything. He never took me to a movie, like, in his entire life. Not one. We didn't do those things. We never did anything. For the whole life, we never did anything. Not one thing. But clearly, both Mom and Dad never transcended themselves, which means, well, the divorce and themselves. They never got over themselves. So they never got on with life. The hatred and those currents, those forces, they never got over that. Dad became addicted to three or four different families of drugs and alcohol, and he eventually shot himself. Both of my brothers stayed with Dad. My older brother, because I think it was the easier course. For him, it's just easier to stay on the place. It's easier to stay in the home. And my younger brother stayed too for the security of when change is happening, it's easier to stay at home. It did not turn out well for him. He committed suicide at 25 years old. My older brother got killed in an airplane accident in the Navy. And let's see. He was 25 also. So he had a bad catapult off an aircraft carrier, went in the water.
It was like a stream. It was one after the other. And so, how did I deal with it? I didn't. I just bore the pain. You just bear the pain. That's how you deal with it. You bear the pain. And you bear it forever. You don't ever get rid of it. You just bear it. You bear it like a knapsack. You bear it like a backpack. You bear it and you carry it, and it's there forever. You don't deal with it. You can't deal with it. You just bear it. I started doing the combines at age five. But driving things by 10, so I had big wooden blocks to so I could reach the pedals. But even then, I had to mostly stand up while I was driving, which wasn't good. If you're off balance, you get in the brake when or the clutch when you're off balance. I did that many times. With a poor outcome. Not disastrous, but not good. And so I went from there and always left alone. I'm a little amazed today that I have all of these things here, the moving machinery, to be alone at 10 or at the age of 5 on a combine. The moving machinery, I am surprised that I have all these pieces. I always was putting these inside of pieces that were moving to work. Yes, I would work around this wheel this big, and I'm in behind the belts, I'm in behind the chains doing what I need to do while things are in motion. So I'm sort of surprised that I came away with all the pieces. I love the dirt, the freshly plowed field. I love dirt. Especially on a hot day, I really like to lie down bareback in the cool soil. I like the dirt better than the grass, even. I love dirt. But I'd lie in the dirt and look at the night sky. But it didn't have the hold on me that Earth did. Although, for me, they were all linked together. Even at the youngest age, what was out there was the same as what was down here. It was just all this... Just all nature. And there wasn't that kind of thing like baseball or Boy Scouts or movies or those other kinds of things maybe that your usual child does. And so they had what they had and I had my forest. And my creatures. I had my creatures and I took care of the cows. I loved the cows. And I loved the cows. I used to ride the cows, but the cows, the animals were my favorite part of the farm. I did everything on the farm. I fed them, I gave them grain, I got the hay in, I took out the manure, and I trimmed the bushes and whatever else and did all the crops. At the youngest of age, I don't know quite what age that was. 4 or 5, I would lie down in the fields. I'd lie down on my back in the grass. And the cows are curious, and of course the cows knew me. And so the cows would all come up. They would surround me where I had a circle. They got as many cows in there as they could. And so I'm lying on my back looking at the sky, and I have a cow coming in from every direction, and you know they're 800 or 900 pounds, but they came in and they would lick my face and lick my hair, and they have a very rough tongue, but I'm looking up at tons upon tons of cows, and I am this little kid lying on its back, and that was a wonderful thing to do. When I was a child, the teachers would take me around, even from first grade to other classes, so I'd tell stories. They was amazed at stories. That wasn't why they called me Story. They called me Story, that was my name. I had my own theater at home, too. I'd take all the chairs in the house and I'd put them all in one room. I'd bring the chairs from every other room and I'd line them all up. That was my theater. If I could have no audience, it wouldn't slow me down. I would do theater. Once in a while, I'd get Mom to sit there, but even if she wasn't there, I would do theater for an empty house. Light gets full. So I was always into storytelling. I was not compatible with school at that, well, hardly at any age. I was not into books. I simply couldn't do books. I didn't understand books. I was an adventurer. It was nature that I wanted. It was the physical world that I wanted. And I was incompatible with the classroom. I was incompatible with the abstract world. And whether it's words as being signifiers or mathematics to represent something or other, I was incompatible. It's the only way I can put it. I was incompatible with the classroom and incompatible with homework. And so I never did homework. When I was on the farm, that part of my schooling, I never did homework. I was never expected to do homework, and I was never helped with homework. I was an adventurer. I was out in the forest. I was climbing the roofs with ropes, up and down fire escapes, up and down anything, out. And so I was an adventurer into the physical world at that time. I rode every animal there was that was large enough to ride. At the age of 4, I rode the Percherons. They were huge draft horses. Without a saddle, without a bridle, I would coax them up to the fence, and then I would, with bits of corn that I coaxed them with, I would walk them along the fence until they brought the rump over. And they were huge, just gigantic things. And then I would talk to them to let them know I was leaping. And I would be on the top of a 5 or 6 foot fence, and I would leap and land with 2 feet onto their rumps. But they knew when I was talking that way that they couldn't move. And from there away I went. I would just grab a bunch of hair. And so I rode the cows, and I rode almost everything, and so I rode the airplane as well. It was just looking at how you managed the situation, how where you wanted to go. I drove airplanes the same way I drove tractors. I kind of taught myself how to fly very well. But at a local grass field, I would get in airplanes and drive them around. I would just drive them around on the grass fields, backwards and forwards, and then I'd start dancing with them. I'd dancing wheel to wheel and the tail wheel up and down and do this. Then I would get going faster and faster dancing. And one day I said, I left a stick in my lap, which means like this, and I kept it going. So now I'm airborne. But I knew exactly how to take care of myself. I knew what I had to know. And I took months at this process, and I was extraordinarily good. It sounds foolhardy, it sounds rash to teach yourself how to fly, but it wasn't in my hands. I started reading aviation manuals in the Marine Corps, and that I could fix anything almost by intuition, but the manual means something, and there are correct ways of doing things, which I did. You don't ad lib, you know, with the military machines, and so I was a magician with them physically, but I also did it correctly. And so I did enjoy the airplane manuals. I got to understand through those manuals. And I think that was my first appreciation of the printed page. And then I did see that without a high school diploma, that there was loads of restrictions to where I might go. I could not be a military pilot, for instance. That was a lesson. You can't fly in the military if you don't have a high school diploma. I got that message. So I went off to college. And I got along with books. As soon as I got into college, I was compatible with books. And of course, I got into books more and more over the decades. I became an incredibly good student over the decades and a very, very strong reader. But as soon as I got into college, books were fine and the academic life was fine. The classroom was fine and the homework was fine. It just was almost like a little switch. I can't tell you about the first minutes when I met Patricia in the university dining room. Where'd I meet her? I met her at a dining hall. Let's see. Well, all I can say is we started dating in college. We got to know each other pretty well in college. And then I went off to work. And then I went to graduate school, and she stayed back in college. And then after graduate school, we got together again, got married, and started a family. So we went off to medical school together, and we had three children during medical school. People told me I wasn't studying hard enough. But we had a delicious, marvelous time. A very young family, children age 1, 2, and 3 in the middle of New York City. It might not seem compatible, but here you have, I was pure country. I was raised in the country, but I took to New York City as if I was one of them. And so we, as a very young family and getting started in medical school, New York City was a perfect place to start a marriage and to go to medical school and to raise a young family. We all had a marvelous time there, and it took no money. In New York City, there's so much going on. I love the electricity. I love the different cultures. When I visit cities now, I go to the cathedrals first. I love a cathedral that like the forest here. You go that way, just like my trees do here. And up there, there's light. So it's here. You look at the different leaves, and you look at the there. Well, good reminder of stained glass. And so that's what the cathedrals do. They rise you like this. But I visit a city. I usually do the cathedrals first, and then the art galleries, and then the museums. In medical school, I was not flying professionally, but I was flying, and so I was increasing my skills and my experience. I also took up parachuting in medical school, and at a well-known parachuting center. Patricia, my wife, was unbelievably tolerant and enthusiastic about it. Neither of us could tell that it was going to lead to my getting into space, and it did lead directly to space. She didn't know about that future, of course, but she was unbelievably tolerant. She could have questioned what is the rationality of being a father of three in medical school to become a doctor, and what is the rationality of what you're doing to run off every other weekend and go parachuting. But I had some urge for the sky up there. And if you look at where the path ended up, there was a rationality, but it was impossible to see back then. And so I have incredible affection and admiration for her to somehow sense that this was an okay thing to do. When we started surgical training in Kentucky, we had 40 acres. We had an old house that had the big trees
On either side of the drive was a very old, run-down house, but we adored it. And so we had a huge amount of land for nothing surrounding the house. And the whole medical school would come to that house for their annual party. They would all, the whole university would come out to our place, and I would parachute into the backyard as an entrance. I would come from the skies into my backyard. So we started out as quite compatible, and we were marvelous parents, and we raised a marvelous family. We became incompatible. I went in one direction, I grew very expansively in one direction, so we went our own ways. We are extraordinarily friendly today and visit all the time. Am I lonely today? I would say that I am lonely today. I would love to be swept away by the love of my life. I would love that to happen. I would love to have a woman come in my life and just sweep me off the earth. It's hard to say how lonely I am. I don't know most of those things about myself. I can't answer the question. I cannot answer the question, am I happy? I have no idea. I have no idea if I'm happy. People tend to think I'm hard on myself, and I'm not sure. I certainly challenge myself, and I certainly ask a lot of myself, whether I'm severe or not. It's hard to tell. I do appreciate myself, and I do love myself. I love myself. It doesn't mean I'm the best or the brightest, and I'm not bragging, but I do love myself. I love who I am, I love what I do, and I love myself. I laugh at myself, I smile at myself. When I screw up, I usually laugh. And how could you be so stupid, you know? But, so I'm not sure. I probably hold a hugely high standards, and I probably expect an immense amount. But I'm not sure that I'm hard on myself. The quest pulls, I can't do anything about the quest. The quest, that drive, I can't do anything about the drive, so you let it run you. Whatever that drive is, the quest, since age 3. On the other hand, well, what would you like to be in life? How would you like to do life? And so, things may be just right. It may be just right. When you live on the edge, it takes a while for the community or the culture that you belong to understand who you are and what you have to offer. When you're living on the edge, or you're outside of the edge, which I never am, I walk that edge. I don't work from the outside. If you work from the outside, you're simply irrelevant. So I believe if you're going to make a difference, you need to make it from the inside. If you start going up the line now, then you have problems with being on the edge. If you become a bureaucratic institution which wants to maintain the established culture and who is afraid of change, afraid of evolution, and if you get people who don't want change, then by definition, I am a threat. I am charismatic. I can't communicate. I always say it the way it is, and I don't mind speaking my piece. If you're not willing to be introspective to yourself
introspective to your institution and find out how it's failing and how it could be better and how we're going to change this darn place, then I am a threat. The being wrapped up in yourself is concentrating on the human code as opposed to your Earth code, the cosmic code. You know, it's the cosmic code. It produced us. Again, my thinking in no way precludes a divine being. I just don't tell the divine being exactly how she did it, when or how. But the cosmic code is us. Galactic evolution, you got Earth evolution, you got suns born and die, stars born and die, you got this continual interchange of energy and matter. That's us. Science is a very powerful paradigm, but it doesn't wish to deal with subjectivity. It wishes it weren't there, but it is here. And the ideas of everyone is always working, the dualism, science and religion, you know, subjectivity, objectivity. One cosmos produced it all. A physical world produced spirituality. You can't deny our spirituality. But a physical world produced our spirituality and our subjectivity. The dichotomies are human categories so that you can feel better about your understanding of things. You cut the whole world up, but no one bothers to put it together. But who we are, where we came from, and where we ought to be going, it's there. It's in the cosmos. It's in Earth. And Earth is that part of the cosmos that made us. And we are concentrating on ourselves. We are totally egocentric. We are only looking at the human code. We're living on a monitor, which is human. The humans built a monitor, and the message on a monitor is created by humans and for humans. It reminds me of having taken a flight in a Boeing 777 from San Juan, Puerto Rico, to Orlando and the Bahamas. The fantastic blues, the most powerful blues, visceral blues on Earth. What was out the airplane window was extraordinary. Just extraordinary. It was so beautiful, you could almost not bear it. When I broke away from the window, I looked around and I did not see one other person looking out the window. I got out of my seat intentionally. I walked all the way down to the front of the airplane, crossed over, went all the way to the back again. Maybe 400 people, not one person on the whole airplane was looking out the window. They had their game, they had their monitor, they had their tube. And when I talk about the genetic code versus the human code, every single person on that airplane was living on the human code. Not one was living on the Earth code. When you talk about Earth code, you're also ignoring the body. And the body's part of the business, and your relationship to the Earth is done through the senses and done through the body. And so if you live on a tube, you're also ignoring your body at the same time. And so that's a contact that we need to get back. The way I view the current culture and the current trajectory of culture is we have to get back to the body and we have to get back to Earth. The lessons are really there. Those are the true lessons. Space gives you that kind of bigger picture of things, but it is not as rooted. It is not as rooted as having your feet in the mud. It's nothing quite as powerful as seeing the life and death, you know, here. Being on Earth is more powerful than being in space. The things I'm doing today are more creative. They're more challenging than anything I did in spaceflight. What I have today, I can't be sad about not flying in space. I'm going forward with bigger challenges. I like art. Like art is a bigger challenge. Like creativity is a bigger challenge. Like creating art out of whatever space experiences I have had and other things. And so space is a fairly small proportion of the kind of art and creations and inventions that I'm coming up with. It's part of it. Now I'm going to pursue beauty. I'm going to do beauty. It is my calling. It is my calling, exactly as space was my calling. I'm going to do beauty as I did tractors and airplanes and medicine, spaceflight and other things. I'm simply going to do it. What is it? Why is it important? How do you get to understand it? What are the factors? How do you make it? How do you know when you're face to face with it? How do you know? Right there. I'm going to reinvent myself one more time. And people don't like the idea that I'm going to do it one more time. They don't understand doing beauty. They don't understand that. They don't like the idea when I say one last time and this is it. And I think it's great because it's, where else would you want to end up, you see, beauty? Where else would you want to finish?
Purple yellows on a campus green. Bird's nest, woman's womb. Green reeds, green life, red life. Transformations, translations, translocations, trans, transit, birth, life, and death. Transit, earth, planet, sun, galaxies, and universe. Oh, immortal soul. Water, muddy water, blood, bloody water, mud and blood in my heart. Fire of sun, fire of ants, fire my soul. Heart-shaped leaves fed by vessel vines. Canopies of life fed by floors of death. Sun of life, shades of death, explosions of spring springing to my mind. Spanish mosses motioning, Chinese chimes swinging in my life. Rhythms of the universe beating to my soul. The wasp loved dead wood, the wasp eat dead wood. Mud loving tracks, life loving